Hey everyone, I'm Abbey Sharp. Welcome to Abbey's Kitchen. Today's video, we will be reviewing minimalist lifestyle YouTuber and supermom to be of four, Sarah Therese. But first, my general disclaimer, which you can find on screen and below in the description, including a trigger warning to those with disordered eating histories, as I will be discussing macros and calories. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel and ring that little bell so that you never miss out on a episode. All right, I'm a fellow mama, so I don't waste any time. Let's get into it. Tell me what you eat and I'll tell you what you are.
When I'm really trying to figure out how much water I am drinking in my day, I like having a visual. This is almost a liter. Hold on. Okay, let's do something. We're gonna see how much water is actually in here. If you fill it up to the line, it's 840 mils, but let's just see. Okay. How many? It is a liter. It's 1,008 milliliters. So I like to drink three of these a day, which hits me at 3 liters.
Okay, so this sounds like a solid amount of water for a pregnant woman. I know we all have it drilled into our brain that we need 8 8-ounce glasses of water a day. The truth is that this is highly variable as a recommendation between people and even within people from day to day, depending on the weather, activity, time of year, time of month, etc. But we do need a bit more during pregnancy since water helps all the nutrients that you consume get to your growing baby. Plus, it helps to reduce the risk of common pregnancy side effects like UTIs, hemorrhoids, and constipation. So I think her hack of using a clear bottle, like a SodaStream bottle, to help her keep tabs on her consumption is really smart. When you can see something in front of you, it's just easier to be more mindful about it. And I'm sure that with 3 other kids, it's easy for any act of self-care to, you know, slip your mind.
Tonight's meal plan is sourdough pita pockets, or like stuffed pita. I am not affected at all by dairy while I am pregnant, but I still like to stay away from it as much as possible. But I have started to eat butter, which is very unlike me, but it is actually better for your body to break down like a grass-fed butter versus a vegan butter.
First of all, I just need to say that I am shook that this woman has 3 children and yet somehow manages to make pita bread from scratch and set up a tripod and camera to film the whole experience. I low-key feel insecure right now. I mean, I'm gonna be real with you guys. I find it so chaotic in my house trying to get like little moments of work done between nap and nursing sessions that I am always rushing to shoot anything, never mind trying to make sure it's like beautifully framed. So if you're wondering why my vlog content doesn't look like this, it's because I have not yet reached this level of divine organization. I am over here just trying to plan shoot days around the one day a week that I wash my hair. I am not feeding a sourdough starter and making pita bread from scratch. So kudos to you. But anyways, she's not wrong about the sourdough. For folks who have non-celiac gluten intolerance or who just have sensitive tummies in general, sourdough can be a better tolerated option. The wild yeast and bacteria in a sourdough starter essentially pre-digests some of the FODMAPs and gluten in the bread because it's fermented for so long. But in traditional bread made with fast-rising yeast, there just isn't time for the yeast to do that work. The result is a bread that's lower in FODMAPs and also somewhat lower in gluten as well. So while not gluten-free, it might be a bit easier for folks with IBS. As for her comments on grass-fed butter versus vegan butter, I'm not sure what her reasons are for avoiding dairy if it doesn't affect her in pregnancy, but that's a personal choice. I'm not going to get into it because I don't know. But I will say that the debate over what kind of spread is healthier probably depends on your definition of healthy. If we look at the nutrition labels of like a grass-fed butter versus a vegan butter, they both have virtually the same amount of calories and fat, with the butter containing more saturated fat and the vegan butter containing more omega-6 fats. both of which have some potential health concerns when consumed in excess. I mean, Sarah does say that, you know, the canola oil and stuff is terrible for you, but the big difference to me is the ingredients, additives, and salt in vegan butter versus grass-fed butter. The ingredients in a grass-fed butter are literally just cream. Whereas a vegan butter contains a mixture of oils like palm, soybean, canola, as she mentioned, and or coconut, plus usually salt, flavor, color, protein, and sometimes emulsifiers. I'm not really concerned with any of these things. It sounds like she is, but this is just an FYI, and it probably also explains why Sarah chooses the dairy over the vegan spread. As a minimalist, it just is a more minimal and simple product. But ultimately, butter or vegan butter is not gonna make or break your diet. It's not poison, it's not toxic, so we can cut that moralizing language out of our repertoire. But like sugar, whatever you choose, just use it mindfully as a source of pleasure and as a complement to other nourishing foods like whole grain bread. All right, what's next?
Put on some yakin syrup. It's a prebiotic. At the beginning of my pregnancy, I had a ton of this to fight off my usual yeast infections. It's pretty much just a sweet syrup that's really good for your gut. So I'll just top some on top. I'm gonna put some blueberries on top. I'm going to eat it now.
So I also always end up with like a massive bowl of oatmeal or cereal after I finish adding in all my favorite sprinkles and fruit and additions and nuts and things like that. But Sarah's version looks totally delicious. I love that we have some fiber-rich carbs in the oats and fruit, plus some protein and fat in the hemp, chia, flax, and seeds. Literally, she's got all my favorite sprinkles going in. As for the yakin syrup, she is right that it's rich in a prebiotic fiber called inulin, which not only helps to feed the good bacteria in our gut, but also makes it a popular choice for folks with blood sugar issues because the fibers help to lower the glycemic index of the sugar. There is even some very small early research to support its use in weight loss efforts and managing insulin resistance. Having said that, that same inulin fiber also means that yakin syrup is not always well tolerated by people with sensitive tummies. And since it sounds like Sarah may have some sensitivities with regards to gluten, etc., yakin may or may not be triggering as well. So again, it just goes to show that what may be a miracle health food for one person could be really problematic for others. Now, will it prevent yeast infections? I mean, that's a stretch. We do have modest evidence that probiotic vaginal suppositories can help to prevent yeast infections. And we know that prebiotics help to feed probiotics so that they can thrive and survive. So sure, like a healthy gut is always a good thing. But I think it's pretty wishful thinking to assume that a tablespoon of some kind of sugar in your oatmeal that's slightly higher in fiber than maple syrup or brown sugar is going to be enough to ward off or cure a yeast infection if you're naturally prone. You need a lot of syrup to get much of a prebiotic effect, and I wouldn't recommend anyone purposefully up their intake of sugar to prevent a yeast infection. Just saying.
And bitter things are like really, really awful to me. They usually give me pretty bad heartburn and it's really acidic on my tongue and it tastes really metal and weird.
Oh yeah. Story of my life, girl. Story of my life. Anyone who's ever been pregnant knows all about food aversions, especially to like bitter foods. I also was turned off of coffee my entire first trimester. And you guys know that is not normal for me. The best research that we have on food aversion suggests that while we know they are related to pregnancy hormones and nausea, we don't have a definitive explanation for what turns us off, especially because it can be highly individualized. But in the case of bitter foods, it's often assumed that this is a primal survival mechanism designed to ward us off of potentially harmful elements in foods. So apparently that's why I spent 12 weeks of my last pregnancy ordering Greek salad and just eating off the cheese. Lettuce is apparently dangerous shit. But kind of, it actually can be. Anyways,
So I do overdose with like an almond milk creamer, which usually I try to stay away from almond milk creamers because there's a lot of gums in it and starches that is just like unnecessary, but it's what I'm doing during this pregnancy.
All right, you guys know what I always say about coffee. Drink it how you like it and do not feel bad about it for a second. I don't care if you're drinking your lattes with 30% whipping cream. If that's what you need to start your day with a smile, then work that into your daily diet somehow. I mean, I'm not gonna say shit. You figure that one out. Especially though, if you're pregnant. Especially if you're pregnant with three other children to somehow keep alive. Have the damn almond creamer. As for the gums in creamer like gelin, guar gum, xanthan, and carrageenan, there is often a lot of negative buzz in health circles about their impact on gut permeability and an increased risk of bowel disease. But the evidence that we have of this is largely done on rats or simulators, and research done on humans haven't really noted any major adverse effects. Having said that, again, for some folks with sensitive tummies, excessive amounts can cause diarrhea, gas, and an altered gut microbiome. So it may be something to monitor if you consume a lot of foods with emulsifiers and gums, but otherwise, a little creamer in your coffee, probably not a big deal.
I feel like I need to say it again, but again, I mean, we can ignore breakfast on this point. I don't eat really big meals, but I will snack throughout my day. Snacks are very exciting and important to me.
So this looks delicious. We've got some protein in the eggs and fat in the cheese and butter, which was a vegan cheese. It is a pretty small and lower carb meal, but she did have a large bowl of carb-rich oats at breakfast. And Sarah consistently says in this video that she's just like a grazer by nature. She doesn't really usually eat big meals. So if having smaller meals throughout the day helps her manage her pregnancy appetite and symptoms, that works for me. As long as she's getting enough throughout the day or throughout the weeks, it really doesn't matter to me how or when she eats.
We get these oranges from a local market and they're like huge. I mean, this local market makes huge oranges and huge apples. Like, these are huge. I believe these are called heirloom navels, which is like a really old belly button, I guess.
So yeah, awesome. Here's a little carb action to complement the eggs from earlier on. I also was obsessed with tart, juicy foods in both of my pregnancies, and a really good orange always hits the spot.
These are vegan dark chocolate chips, and this is just a unsweetened natural peanut butter. Whether I'm pregnant or not, this is what I do. I know a lot of people put it into a date and like freeze it. You can do that, power to you. This is what I do. Grab that peanut butter into there. This is our snack. What a combo.
Oh, and that, my friends, is how you do a snack. It's like a fly trap, but with chocolate. Genius. Also, not that anyone needs a reason to eat peanut butter out of a jar, but this is actually a really great snack in pregnancy for its potential role in reducing allergens. One study found that moms who consumed peanuts and tree nuts 5 times a week or more during pregnancy had a lower risk of their kids developing an allergy to that food. So yeah, do not mess with a pregnant lady and her ladle of PB. Obviously, if we wanted to make this a more satiating snack, we could smear that peanut butter and sprinkle the chocolate chips onto a piece of whole grain bread or like a tortilla and roll it up. But I mean, I'm not gonna give a pregnant lady a hard time for eating a ladle worth of peanut butter with some dark chocolate chips. All the power to you, girl.
You go, Glen Coco.
Having that because that's what I want to have. And if I want to have a peanut butter cup, girl, I have those. In Justin's dark chocolate peanut butter cups. Pretty much the exact same thing that I just did, but with more sugar. There's also palm oil in here. But these are a treat and very good.
Okay, so I love that Sarah is legitimately just satisfying her PB and chocolate craving the way she wants. And if she wants the real deal, she's got a packaged snack in the fridge at the ready. As for her choice in candy bar, I too love me a Justin's dark chocolate peanut butter cup, but would it satisfy my cravings for like a Reese? Probably not. And honestly, if we compare the nutrition labels of a Reese's and a Justin's peanut butter cup, the difference is kind of negligible. The Reese's has 4 grams more sugar, but it also has fewer calories, slightly more protein and fiber, and also less saturated fat. It also doesn't contain palm oil, as she mentions, which does have some controversy around it due to its role in deforestation and its impact on wildlife. But as Sarah mentioned, this is a treat for her, whether that's due to the sugar or environmental concerns for her, I don't know. My message here is to choose the peanut butter chocolate candy that you actually really like and just enjoy it in moderation. Let's see what's for dinner.
We're gonna make a cashew cream tzatziki. Again, I made this yesterday and I let it ferment overnight, so now the gluten will not affect my head and give me.
This looks like an awesome meal. Totally my style. We've got some fat from some homemade vegan cashew-based tzatziki sauce and the Greek vinaigrette. Protein in the chicken here, some nice, fresh, fiber-rich veg, and of course, the carbs in the amazing homemade pita, which is still blowing my mind. What I love most about this meal is that her family is involved in every step of the way. She involved her sweet little kiddos in shaping and rolling and snacking on the sourdough, and everyone sat down at the table for a family meal. And speaking of family style, I generally recommend serving meals family style to children rather than pre-plating their meals. As I discussed in my video on raising an intuitive eater right here, our job as a parent is to determine what to serve and when, and our kids' job is to decide what and how much they are going to eat. It's important to always have at least one safe food on the table, which you know that they're gonna like. Usually that's like a bread or some kind of carb, but then to allow them the autonomy to navigate what and how much they eat of the different foods available. This is the most reliable way to raise a competent eater and to reduce the risk of picky eating long-term.
This is the time that the kids have gone down to bed, and this is the rest of my water that I'm to drink, which will be very easy because that was a very garlic, salty, creamy, forward meal. So I'll be drinking a lot of water. I also want to show you guys, these are my prenatal vitamins. These are Smarty Pants. It's omega-3, folate, D3, B12, and just free of a bunch of things like allergens, like the most common. So the reason these are so good is that they're in gummy form.
So I'm really glad that she mentioned taking a prenatal supplement, and it's not uncommon for a lot of expectant moms to have a hard time swallowing traditional pills, so gummies have become a really popular choice. But as discussed in my video on multivitamins right here, gummy vitamins are notoriously hard to make well. A lot of nutrients, like iron, don't taste so good, so they're typically omitted or found in really small amounts. Most gummies are also high in sugar, and when tested, a lot of them have major overages and underages compared to what their label states. In fact, an investigation by consumerlab.com found that almost all of the gummy vitamins that they tested were problematic. I will say that the Smarty Pants brand that they tested, while not the prenatal one specifically, did pass their purity test. So that at least is a good thing. But on the topic of gummy supplements, I do want to flag that I watched another one of Sarah's videos where she mentioned that she regularly took a melatonin-based sleep gummy by Herbaland. And while the risk and benefit of using sleep aids in pregnancy should be discussed on a case-by-case basis with your doctor, it is worth pointing out that melatonin isn't considered well-studied in pregnancy, at least not for ongoing use. And when I asked my doctor about melatonin use myself in pregnancy, my doctor actually suggested using Gravol or Diclectin instead, as we have a lot more safety data on that. But anyways, I'm not here to shame any mama for doing what she needs to do for her mental health, but I just want to point out that sometimes even natural things aren't necessarily your safest bet, especially not in pregnancy. Anyway, on that note, let's round up the stats. According to my calculations, on this day, Sarah's consuming about 1,900 calories with about 20% from protein, 37% from carbs and 43% from fat. So this is a higher fat, lower carb diet, but if this dietary pattern feels good to her, it works for me. She's also hitting her targets for most of her micronutrients and fiber, though even with the prenatal, she is low on most notably calcium, potassium, and iron. So she may want to rethink her prenatal choice to find a supplement that has some iron. And actually, Smarty Pants does have a PhD version that has a little bit of iron in it. So now let's talk about what I like. I think it's very clear that Sarah eats a nutrient-dense diet with a nice variety of ingredients, and with the exception of most wheat products and apparently dairy products, she doesn't seem to cut out a bunch of foods. So she has bread and meat and butter and chocolate and even coffee creamer with actual sugar in it. And she seems to be honoring her body and her desires to help her get through this pregnancy without worrying too much about her diet being perfect all the time. That's really nice to see. And with the exception of maybe making her own sourdough pita breads while keeping three babies and another one on the way alive, which, let's be real, is ambitious as f***. Her meals do seem pretty accessible. There are a lot of nutrient-dense whole foods going on, like nut butters, seeds, oats, and eggs, and less emphasis on superfood powders and diet foods or supplements that we see so often in a lot of these videos. So these are meals that I think a lot of folks could probably make at home, and that would be generally agreeable to other families that have kids as well. Now, let's switch gears here and discuss some simple tips for optimizing nutrition as Sarah moves through the rest of her pregnancy and onto postpartum life. I think Sarah is doing an amazing job feeding herself and her growing babe. I am pretty sure that if I had three young kids, I would probably be living off of their toast crusts, so kudos to her for actually sitting down to legitimate meals and snacks. That is more ambitious than I could probably ever attempt. Now, since calcium is one of the major nutrients of concern in pregnancy, and her intake is a little bit low on this day, I would recommend trying to find a few more ways to sneak more in, even if she's not doing dairy. So maybe try cooking the oats in a fortified milk alternative, throw some dark leafy greens into the eggs, or add some tofu set with calcium sulfate into the dinner rotation. That might help. She could also up her iron a little bit by adding some apricots to her oats and some beans or fortified grains into her snacks. Finally, let's just touch briefly on Sarah's perceived relationship with food. And of course, a reminder that I don't know Sarah. I'm literally going off of the videos that I've watched of hers, and she doesn't always talk about food in every single one. But it seems to me that in line with her minimalist, wholesome brand, Sarah really aims to eat a nutrient-dense diet packed with homemade whole foods most often. And that's great. There is definitely a bit of moralizing around certain ingredients, particularly additives, added sugar, gluten, and other processed foods. I have heard her call ingredients out as nasties a lot, which is a word that I personally really hate. But in the grand scheme of influencers and diet culture, it seems like it's more of an awareness and a preference thing than a flat-out obsession, which I think is totally valid and fair. It sounds like she's willing and able to give herself grace to enjoy some of these less nutritious foods or ingredients if they help bring some pleasure, satisfaction, and convenience to her life. And girl, you do not need to justify anything to me. Drink that coffee creamer and eat those peanut butter cups all you damn want. I did see one video where she was talking about parenting mistakes that she's made, and she was talking about how she regretted worrying so much about her kids eating healthy foods easily. And this is a really common stressor for parents, so it was really nice to see that relatability. But ultimately, as parents, it's not up to us how easily our kids accept fruits and vegetables. Like I said, it's our job to determine what foods we feel comfortable feeding our kids, but it's their decision what they actually eat. And pediatric feeding specialists agree that adding pressure almost always results in the opposite outcome, and our kids end up eating less or obsessing over the bad foods that we're trying to limit. In that video, she also mentioned using a no thank you bite as a tactic where her kids have to at least try the healthy food, even if they don't want to actually eat it and finish it. And I know this is controversial, but my pediatric RD colleagues generally agree that even this is considered a form of negative pressure. So I personally do not believe in the no thank you bite. But it does sound like over time, she's been able to find a way to give her kids a little more autonomy over their eating and also give herself some grace and understanding that ultimately she can't control that kind of shit anyways. I imagine that if I had three kids and I was pregnant, I would have very few f**ks left to give. Having said all that, I do just want to remind everyone that language is very important. How we talk about foods, especially in front of our kids, really matters. So if we're calling sugar or processed foods nasties, or labeling foods as good, bad, healthy, junk, this often sets our kids up to want them even more when they do have access. And birthday parties happen, so they're gonna have access. So my best advice here is to prevent all foods, both broccoli and cupcakes, with neutrality, even if you're kinda freaking out inside. And on that note, that is all that I have for you guys today. If you liked it, be sure to give it the thumbs up. Leave me a comment below on what you would like to see in your review next. Subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you next time on Abby's Kitchen. Bye. And for more great videos like this, check out the link right here.